Recording.
Yes.
Okay, so welcome everybody back. So we have the second and final lecture of today. And it is a great pleasure to have Yakov Pessin from Penn State University. And Yakov will talk about Sinai-Huell-Bowen measures for surface diffeomorphisms. Please, Yasha.
Thank you, Yuri. And first of all, I would like to thank organizers for this great opportunity. You know, I was so much missing conferences these days. Of course, we all would like to be, you know, to meet in person, but even this opportunity is a fantastic one. And I especially like the whole idea of that preceded by school, so a lot of participants get first of all involved in the topic, and so it made my life much easier because I wouldn't have to explain some of the notions that I believe everybody by now knows. So the title of my talk is Sinai-Huell-Bowen measures for surface diffeomorphisms. This is a joint work with von Kleinenhager and Stefano Luzzatta. I would like to start by just stating the result as it is. So the setting is that we have a diffeomorphism F of class C1 plus alpha on a compact orientable surface M. So it's a two-dimensional case only. And I claim that the map F admits Sinai-Huell-Bowen measure if and only if the three conditions holds. The first condition is that this map has a nice domain. I call it gamma PQ, and I will explain what this PQ means and gamma means and what the nice domain is. Then it has also a regular set, lambda L. And again, it's not clear why L is here, what L means, and I will explain all of that. And the third condition is non-empty Lebesgue strongly recurrent subset A in here. That's a short condition. And again, I will explain what it is. So if these three conditions hold, then I claim F has a Sinai-Huell-Bowen measure. And in fact, if a map does have such a measure, then these three conditions hold. So it's necessary and sufficient conditions for existence of such a measure. I immediately would like to mention result by Federico Rodriguez-Hertz, Hannah Rodriguez-Hertz, Raul Urs, and Ali Tahibi, which claims that a topologically transitive surface diffeomorphism may have no more than one SRB measure. So it means that if you add to the three conditions that I just mentioned another condition that F is topologically transitive, then you claim that there exists a unique SRB measure for the surface diffeomorphism. So my goal now is explain all the three conditions. And here we go to the notion of nice domain. So a nice domain is a topological disk, and you can see the picture. I denote it by gamma PQ of small size R. How small the size R will be determined later. So we just fix small r and we claim that a topological disk is a nice domain if it's formed by pieces of stable and unstable manifolds, curves actually in our case, of hyperbolic fixed points. So what I claim is that there are two points, P and Q, which are hyperbolic. Naturally, they have stable and unstable separatrices, and those separatrices, we just take the small pieces of this separatrices, local intersect, forming what one can call a rectangle or a domain. And intersection, of course, should be transversal. So that's the notion of nice domain. So why it is nice? Because if you now take the iterates of stable and unstable boundary of this domain gamma PQ, and under multiples of some time t. So the time t is defined by taking just the period of P, period of Q, and for example, multiplying that. But you can take any other number which is multiple of that. And that's number T. So in the whole talk, when I say I consider a time I or time N, it's multiple of T. I do not consider any other time. So for me, the time is T times either the set of natural numbers or the set of integers. And the niceness property means that if you apply this multiples of T to the stable and unstable local boundaries, they do not intersect the interior of this nice domain. So that's a very crucial property, which is uniquely two-dimensional, which we will use. And later on, I will pinpoint the place where that this particular property is used, and there's only one place where it is used. So, and that's the only condition that requires two dimensions. So we hope that eventually one can get rid of this condition and then the result will be multidimensional. But we don't know how to do that. So the second requirement is regular sets. And this is essentially non-uniform hyperbolicity, just stated in the way which I will be using later. So it's called chi epsilon hyperbolicity, meaning that there is a decomposition, the splitting of the tension bundle at every point x on the set lambda, which we call regular set, which we call hyperbolic set. And there is a measurable function c and q, which are epsilon temperate. And that's a property which is written here is exactly the property of being temperate. And then we say that, and then you have this uniform contraction and expansion. Not non-uniform contraction and expansion, the standard contraction along the stable subspaces and when you go backward along unstable, and similarly for when you go backward for stable and backward for unstable. So, the essence of this non-uniform hyperbolic conditions is that I will define this for given set lambda, the given number lambda, I define the set lambda L, which is what I call regular set. So on this set, the constant Cx and Kx are bounded from above and respectively from below, which means that the conditions, the uniform hyperbolicity estimates becomes uniform on that set. That of course has a lot of corollaries. In particular, on the hyperbolic set, you can construct a stable, local, stable, and unstable curves. On a regular set, they become of uniform size, and they depend continuously on the point, etc., etc. There are plenty of good results when you see it on a regular set. The only problem with distinguishing non-uniform hyperbolicity from uniform is that the regular sets are not invariant. However, they are nested, so when L grows, you get bigger sets, and they exhaust the whole set lambda. So that's basically the major properties of the regular sets. The next step is recurrence. So this is the third condition. So we have set lambda, we have local, as I said, we have local stable and unstable set, curves whose sets are uniform on the regular set. And then I pick a subset in lambda L. I say that this subset is recurrent if points in this set returns backward in under backward and forward iterates to the set A every point, which means that every point returns infinitely many times. And when I say iterates again, I take iterates from multiples of T. And which is a major property is Lebesgue strong recurrence. That means that you, first of all, it's recurrent. And second of all, there is a point X in A and a stable leaf through this point such that, which has positive one dimensional Lebesgue measure. So what happened is that you have a point X, you draw the unstable local leaf, And there are a set of positive measures, measure of one dimension of the Beck measure, such that every point on the set belongs to the set A. So the intersection of A with this is a set of positive measures. Why we just take unstable leaf is that you can draw stable leaves. You use absolute continuity to obtain a set of positive measures. And if point A returns to A, then the whole stable leaf returns very close to this area. And that's exactly what we need to use for our construction. This will be kind of an important part of our construction. Okay, so that's that's the three properties under which we require for our result. I would say a few words about SRB measures because I want to define it in a way maybe a little bit different from what you may have heard before, which is that we take a set A and we call it fat if the union of stable leaves through the points in A have positive area. This can be done in general, it can be volume. And then we say that mu is an SRB measure if it is hyperbolic and for every set and the set X, oops, I didn't define the set X, this is X. Or you can say, okay, you can say that the set X, which is fat, has a full measure. So in other words, my X is A. So there is a fat set X, which has full measure. Now, that definition is adjusted to the two-dimensional case. Now, it works fine in the two-dimensional case. In the multidimensional case, there are some differences. You need to do some work to show that this is equivalent to an SRB measure. But in the two-dimensional case, it's essentially the same definition as the classical definition of SRB measure, which is that if you take conditional measures generated by mu, then on unstable leaves, that they are absolutely continuous to leaf volume, which in our case is one-dimensional Lebesgue measure or just the length. So this is the definition of SRB measure, which is a little easier to use in our construction of SRB measure, technically. There's no principal difference, of course. I would like to say that nice domain are, of course, important part of our proof, but it sounds like artificial condition. What I'm arguing is that it is actually not. And the idea is that if you, given by this theorem, that if you have a C1 plus alpha surface diffeomorphism, and mu is an any invariant hyperbolic measure, non-atomic, then given number R, you can construct a nice domain of size R, okay? And in fact, given a number L, you can construct a set A of positive measure, which is recurrent, and this is where I split any, this is true for any hyperbolic measure, but if my measure is SRB, then it is Lebesgue strongly recurrent. So what it means that the conditions that I stated in the theorem, in the main theorem, are necessary conditions for existence of SRB measures in the two-dimensional case, of course. So niceness is necessary to construct SRB measures. And Lebesgue strongly recurrent is also necessary to construct SRB measures. And again, I want to stress that in this statement, I deal with what is called hyperbolic SRB measures. There is a notion of SRB measures which uses this absolute continuity property of local stable manifolds, which is not necessarily hyperbolic. So it allows zero exponent outside of the unstable leaves. But in my cases, all SRB measures are hyperbolic. The measures I'm going to build will be hyperbolic SRB measures. So that's important to stress. I would like to say some few words about construction, some history and some interesting problems related to SRB measures. First of all, as you all know, the SRB measures were constructed for uniformly hyperbolic situation by Sinai and Bowens in the 1970s. And then, so in the for the uniformly hyperbolic case, the works of Sinai and Bowens essentially answered any question, almost any question, I would say, about SRB measures. Certainly existence, uniqueness, and ergodic properties up to Bernoulli. Bernoulli was established by Bowen. However, and the techniques which they used was partitions of finite, subset of finite time. That was a great achievement of the time. It brought not just existence of, it was much more than existence of SRB measure, because it brought the whole idea of symbolic representations of the systems, which opened up a lot of possibilities. Then the next step was constructing of SRB measures for partially hyperbolic system. But I'm gonna skip this part. It's a huge area with a lot of works in this area and a lot of interesting results, ideas, etc. But I'm not gonna talk about this because I will not be mentioning partially hyperbolic system for, by simple reason, in the two-dimensional case, there are no partially hyperbolic diffeomorphisms. So from uniform hyperbolicity, I will jump immediately to non-uniform hyperbolic case. And here there is a conjecture which was posed by Viana at his ICM address in 1998, which it was at the very end of his address, where he says that if you have a C1 plus alpha diffeomorphism with non-zero Lyapunov exponent with respect to volume, so volume is not necessarily an invariant measure. You don't have an invariant measure, you want to build it. And so you just say, I have a set of non-zero Lyapunov exponent of positive volume, or you can even assume that it's full volume, then this system admits an SRB measure. That's an interesting statement. And I will comment on this statement a little bit. First of all, I would like to say that the requirement that C, that diffeomorphisms of C, of the class C1 plus alpha is important because it kind of hints that we want to use non-uniform hyperbolicity. We talk about non-uniformly, non-zero Lyapunov exponent in this conjecture, but I would like to say that if you just have non-zero Lyapunov exponent, that fact does not provide you immediately, at least, with any techniques of non-uniform hyperbolicity. The point is that you need to know more. You need to have, one way to explain this is to say that we need what is called Lyapunov-Perron regular points, the points for which isolated theorem, multiplicative ergodic theorem holds. Without this, it doesn't look like you can use the power of non-uniform hyperbolicity, or at least I don't know anything about how to use non-zero Lyapunov exponent without having sufficiently many regular points, oscillators or Lyapunov-Perron regular points. So here's what I wanted to say about Viana conjecture. Whether it's true or not, it stimulated a great body of work on constructing SRB measures for various systems. So I'm gonna mention two of them. One is my paper with von Klimenhage and Dima Dolgopyat, in which we constructed SRB measures, but we use a new notion of hyperbolicity called effective hyperbolicity. What it actually is, it's a version of non-uniform hyperbolicity, which is adjusted to the to study dissipative systems. Namely, you have an attractor And in the neighborhood of the attractor, you assume that there is a positive volume of points which are effectively hyperbolic. Again, the effective hyperbolicity is somewhat similar to non-uniform hyperbolicity, but it's not the same. It's a new notion of hyperbolicity. And the conclusion is that if you have positive volume of points which are which are effectively hyperbolic, you have an SRB measure. The second result, which is much closer to this talk, is a result of Sneer Benavadi, who constructed SRB measures under conditions which are essentially the ones I just mentioned. It's condition of hyperbolicity, fatness, and strong recurrence. They stated maybe a little bit different way, but essentially they are the same. So what is great about this work is that it works in any dimension. The result by Benavadi does not use niceness property. What it uses instead is countable Markov partitions for systems which are non-uniformly hyperbolic. The construction of this countable Markov partition goes back to early work of Omri Sarif, who did it in the two-dimensional case, and then Sneer Benavadi extended it to any dimensions. And the beauty of having countable Markov partition is that it allows you again to obtain a symbolic representation of the system using Markov shift on a countable state of set of states. This is a great technique, and it had many other important results coming from it, but one of them is the construction of SRB measures. Now, the difference between the result by Sneer and our result is that we do not use Markov partition. Instead, we use a very geometric approach, which would lead us to a different symbolic representation, which is a presentation by Young Towers. And that's what I'm going to explain. And at this point of time, Young Towers have certain advantage in this in the sense of in applications to non-uniformly hyperbolic case than Markov shift of accountable set of states. For example, in terms of studying correlation decays and central limit theorems and stuff like that. I believe that the two representations are somehow are equivalent, and whatever you can get with one, you can get with another, but it's not the state of the art at this point. So let me now also mention that, as I said, I do not see how Vianna conjecture can be proven in general without attributing to one or another type of non-uniform hyperbolicity. There is also another point, which in my view may prevent the Vianna conjecture to be true as stated, is the notion of Lebesgue-Strong recurrence. In our paper and in the work of Sneer, the Lebesgue-Strong recurrence is explicitly required. So you have a set of points which return to itself with in a certain way. I mean, this is a, in particular, they would have a return with positive frequency, which is nowhere to find in the statement of Vianna conjecture. In my paper with Von and Dima, it's not explicitly required, but effective hyperbolicity is stated in a way, and that's where it kind of differs from non-uniform hyperbolicity, is that it essentially produces recurrence. The local stable leaf will, starting with certain size, may go down, but the size can go down, but then it eventually must recover. That is a corollary of effective hyperbolicity. So you do have recurrence, in fact, strong recurrence in the case of effective hyperbolicity. So any of the three results which build SRB measures in non-uniformly hyperbolic case do require strong recurrence property. And I would like to mention a result by my student Alan Sari, which says that in fact, if you have a set of regular points of Lyapunov Perron regular points or oscillated regular points. So points comes from oscillated theorem of full measure. And if you have a subset which is Lebesgue strongly recurrent, then it means that the measure is actually a smooth measure. So you don't get genuine SRB. You get that the volume itself or a measure equivalent to the volume is invariant. So you cannot get much if you have these two properties, except just invariant volume. So that actually shows the intrigue kind of way the conjecture was stated. It's extremely interesting, very stimulating, but nobody knows whether it's true or not, and there is no counterexample, which would be nice to have one. I believe that one exists, but I don't know anything. So let me from now on move to the proof of the main theory. And I remind you that what we have is a non-uniformly hyperbolic set, a nice domain, a regular set, subset A, which is strongly recurrent. And what you want to do is to prove that map F admits an SRB measure. So how are we gonna do about that? First of all, there are a few steps that I'm gonna make, just actually four steps. The first one is the notion of almost recurrent. That's a new notion, new object that have not been before in non-uniform hyperbolicity. Before I stated, I need the notion of a full length stable and full length unstable curves. So what it is that you have a nice domain gamma PQ. You have a point X here. And through this point, you draw a local unstable leaf, local stable leaf. What you want to say is that if the size of the domain is small, and that's where I use a small r, so I fix L, which is the level of regularity, regular set of order L, the sizes of local stable and unstable manifolds here are fixed. And if r is small, that this local leaf is long. So what I do, I just cut it so that its endpoints lie on the unstable boundary of nice domain. And similar is for the unstable. If you have a point Y and you draw unstable leaf, which is of full length, so it goes from one point on the stable boundary to another point on the stable boundary. And then there is a notion of almost return. So you take a point X in A, this is my point, and it returns to a nice domain. So and under the time I call it FIX. What happened is that if it returns to A, then this is what I would call true return. That's the best situation. It may not, it is back to nice domain, but it may not be returning to A. So it will be somewhere in this domain. Enormous domains means that it's close enough to the set A in the sense that if you take the image of the stable local manifold, that it, oops, I'm sorry. This is where it is. This is an image. And then there is a point Y in A such that you draw the full length unstable curve and it intersects. So if you have this situation, then you say, my return is almost return. You are very close to actual true return. So what I'd like you to understand that when you take a point X and A and you return to the nice domain, there are three possibilities. One is a true return. Second one is an almost return. And the third, when the point comes somewhere and the stable leaf is like this, and it doesn't intersect any of the unstable leaves through the points in A. That's, you can say that this image of the stable leaf falls into a gap. So returns, true returns, and almost returns are not gaps. Otherwise, it's a gap. So that's the notion of an almost return. And once you have an almost return, you can kind of start playing the game. Namely, before I do this, I want to say that local stable and unstable manifold exists only through the point in on a regular set. We need to extend this regular set. For that, we don't know how to do that because we don't have stable and unstable leaf outside of regular set. So, but what we can do is we can deal with admissible manifolds. Admissible manifolds, as I believe most of you should know, maybe everyone knows, is almost local leaves. So what you have a stable leaf through good point, regular point, and there is a cone which you build in the tangent space that you can build at every regular point. And the cone depends continuously on the point. So you can draw curves which, if you leave them by exponential map, they will lie in a cone. So they're close to the genuine unstable and or respectively unstable curve, but they're not real stable and unstable curve. So they are stable or unstable if you move them by finite time. Their behavior is pretty much good, close to the actual local stable manifolds. But if the time is infinite, they do not survive in that sense. So however, I'm going to use them. So I will extend the collection of local stable and unstable manifold to allow local admissible curves. And I'm going to use them to construct stable and respectively unstable strip. So that is an actual two-dimensional domain, which is bounded by pieces of stable and unstable curves through periodic points P and Q, and some local admissible stable or unstable manifold. If I have those domains, I call them stable and unstable strip. And here is maybe the main property that main notion that we need. The notion of a hyperbolic branch. So what it is, you have a stable strip here, and it maps into an unstable strip. So you have stable strip, and you have an unstable. So let me look at this picture. So you have a stable strip, an unstable strip. So what I'm saying is that you take a stable strip and you apply some power of the map. And it goes, the stable strip shrink in the stable direction, expand in the unstable direction. And if the time is chosen appropriately, the image will be this unstable strip. It may not happen. You don't know if such time exists or not. But what I'm saying is that if it happened, then I call the pair a hyperbolic branch. And the time is an intrinsic part of this hyperbolic branch. So it's two strips and the time that makes a hyperbolic branch. And here is the main result, which says that if you take a point X and it returns to A, almost returns to A under time, which, and again, I stress it, the time I consider a multiple of the capital T. The capital T is needed to use a nice property. So if it returns back to A, almost returns to A at some time I, which is multiple of T, then there exists a hyperbolic branch, which is absolutely non-trivial result. And it's a major part of our construction. I would like to make few results. First of all, once you have a point in a non-uniformly hyperbolic set, there is a so-called regular neighborhood around this point. It has a property that's another weight of describing regular sets is that in the small neighborhood around the point X, whose size depends on X, the map Fi is uniformly hyperbolic from Nx to the image, to the regular neighborhood at the point Fix. So that's an important property of regular neighborhood. Of course, when X runs through the regular set, the size of regular neighborhood is fixed. And this is very important. So we have two numbers now, C and lambda. Lambda stands for the rate of contraction when you go from one regular neighborhood to another. And C is a constant in the hyperbolicity estimates. And if X lives on this regular set, then those lambda and C are constant. They do not depend on the point. Now, the second comment I want to make, that when we, this regular neighborhood are heavily used in the construction of hyperbolic branches. Namely, the hyperbolic branch are first constructed in regular neighborhood, not on in the nice rectangle, but in an object which is bigger. The regular neighborhood contains our nice domain. They're much bigger. So we use this regular neighborhood to construct hyperbolic branches within this regular neighborhood. Then what we'd like to do is to simply restrict them to the nice domain. If that's exactly where the niceness property is necessary. For example, if you have a regular neighborhood, this is a regular neighborhood which contains our nice domain, and you have a hyperbolic branch, and you want to restrict it, so since you start from X, you don't have the picture like that, because it has to contain the point, starting point, which is inside nice domain. But what can, so the picture that you would like to have is something like that. And then it maps into this. Something like that. However, what can happen is that you start from this point and the stable strip is nice, but unstable strip is something like that. It intersects, it contains a boundary. I'm sorry, the picture maybe not so nice. I will show it a little bit better. So this is a nice domain. You take a point. You have a stable strip, and the unstable strip is like this. So the part of the boundary is inside. That you don't want, because you cannot then restrict on the nice domain. And the nicest property guarantees that it doesn't happen. So then you can restrict. And that's how you get branch property, hyperbolic branch property. That is the only place where the niceness property of the domain is used. So if somehow one can avoid that, then you can do it in the multidimensional case. We don't know. It's pretty much two-dimensional argument, the second part of the proof. But the first part of the proof is not, and it's a new result. Now, another property of hyperbolic branches is what we call concatenation property, which means that you start, you have one nice, one hyperbolic branch, Fi C1 S C1 U, and a second one, which has time J. And then, so you move from this one to this one, and from this one to this one. So what you would like to do is you would like to move from, apply time I plus J, so you go from this dark rectangle into through this one, to the dark rectangle here. So the corresponding parts, the corresponding strips are given by these two formulas. What this new strip that you obtain is called the concatenation of the original branches. Now, if you just look at what, I mean, if your two branches are C lambda branches, so you have constant C and lambda, then a priori, the branch which you obtained as a concatenation branch would have constant C square account. So the constant will grow as you concatenate branches. If you do it multiple, infinitely many times, you get a huge constant in front. It turns out that you can construct hyperbolic branches, C lambda hyperbolic branches, such that the resulting concatenation branch is C lambda, no matter how many, but finitely many concatenation branches you will use. So that's another one important result in constructing hyperbolic branches. So the first lemma claims that you can construct one. The second claims that you can construct in a way that it keeps those branches to be C lambda hyperbolic branch. So here I also would like to say that, I already mentioned that, so I will skip that. So the next step is the notion of a saturated rectangle. So remember what we have. We have a set subset A, which is regular, it lies inside of regular set, has Lebesgue strong recurrent property, et cetera, et cetera. What we would like to do is we would like to extend it to build a rectangle. A rectangle is a set which has hyperbolic local product structure. It means that you take a point X in gamma, then it is an intersection of local stable and local unstable curves through some two points of in gamma. So every point in gamma is an intersection of local stable and unstable curves through points in gamma. So that's a notion of rectangle. The difference between this rectangle and kind of a well-known rectangles on the plane is that first of all, the boundaries are kind of curves, but more important is that it's, as I said, it may be like a counter-like set. It doesn't fill any domain a priori. So what we want to do, we want to construct a rectangle which contains in the domain, a nice domain, and it is saturated. Now, what it is, the notion of saturation is another new important element of the proof. What it means that, there are several meanings of this property and it will be used in several ways. But first of all, it is a maximal invariant set for the dynamics within this nice domain, which is generated, being maximal in a sense that it's generated by hyperbolic branches associated to almost returns. Now, what it means? It means that I draw a pair, analogy with the standard horseshoe. In the standard horseshoe, you have two rectangles, which are basic rectangles, which is what the construction starts with. And then the construction goes by building the maximal invariant set, which consists of points which remains in these two strips in forward and backward times, infinite forward and backward times. So the difference between the construction of saturated rectangles, the idea of saturating is pretty similar to that one. But the key difference is that in the horseshoe setting, you can have at most finitely many branches, which are pairwise disjoints of stable and unstable strips. In our case, every point can belong to infinitely many hyperbolic branches. So in horseshoe setting, there's one branch, one of the two strips to which it belongs. In kind of an original trips, when you start the whole construction. In our settings, this is, you may have infinitely many such branches when you start the construction. So in a sense, the construction of horseshoe is also a construction by hyperbolic branches. The difference is that those hyperbolic branches are associated with true returns. We do not consider any almost returns. And as I said, you may have infinitely many branches which would contain a given point. So that makes a huge difference in our construction, but the idea is exactly to construct the maximal invariant subset. So to do that, what I would like to do is I consider all possible hyperbolic branches, which comes out of almost return. So you start with A, you consider all possible almost return. To each, you construct a hyperbolic branch, and you get a collection of hyperbolic branches. Now, since F is a diffeomorphism of compact manifold, its derivative is bounded, which means that for a given time I, you can have only finitely many such branches, which means that the collection of all hyperbolic branches that I just described can be indexed by two indices I and J, where I is the return time for almost return, and J goes from one to some finite number MJ. Okay, so once we choose this collection of indexes, you have the collection of corresponding branches, which are the branches which you obtain by using almost returns. So this is kind of a symbolic way using hyperbolic branches to describe the dynamics of of points which belongs to this hyperbolic set. So the saturated rectangle consists of all points X for which there is a sequence of hyperbolic branches. Again, hyperbolic branches which are obtained from almost return, such that the orbit falls into stable strip under iteration of the corresponding return times. So that's, again, that's pretty much similar to construction of horseshoes, but of course it's much more elaborative because we are in a completely different setting. So this way we have constructed saturated rectangle, and it has the following important properties: that you take a point in X in A and consider, then it's all, and consider its almost return, then it's actual true return to gamma, because points in A, is a part of gamma. So you take a point in A which belongs to gamma, then almost return of this point is actually a true return to gamma. Second, because A is Lebesgue strongly recurrent, gamma is also Lebesgue strongly recurrent. And third is that if you have a point X in gamma, then you can construct two sequences, one going forward, another one going backward, such that if you take images of X under the finitely many iterations by returns to, associated with hyperbolic branches forward, you fall into the corresponding stable strip. And similarly for when you go backward. So these two sequences, one goes forward and one goes backward, can be viewed as a symbolic representation built by hyperbolic branches. So this is a different type of symbolic representation. It's not Markov shifts. It is not Young towers. It's a different type of symbolic representation in this case. And we use it to carry out our proof. So the next step is Young towers. So once you have a saturated rectangle, what we do, we just induce on this saturated rectangle. So we build Young tower, and it will be the first T return time Young tower. So the time will be first return, but it must be multiple of T, such that the base of the tower or inducing domain is my saturated rectangle gamma. And the height time is the first return to gamma. That gives you a tower. Now, of course, it's not a Young tower yet. I mean, it's easy to see that since the base is a rectangle, it has hyperbolic product structure, which is a requirement in constructing of Young tower. But you have to verify other properties, which is a Markov property of returns, property of bounded distortion, and the most important one, integrability of the return time. That's the three properties that you need to check. But in order to do that, first you have to define the partition element of the base. So the Young Tower, as you know, is constructed when you have the base, it partitioned into what is called S sets. And then above S sets, you have returns. So that's kind of an abstract picture of the Young Tower, and I'm pretty much sure everybody knows. So this will be the height. Under this time, the piece returns back to tower, to the base of the tower. So how do we define this partition? The elements which would have the same inducing time. Well, you just take two hyperbolic branches. So what do you know? You take a point X and you have many hyperbolic branches which contain X. So you take two of them. One is at time I, and another one is at time I prime, and it has stable and unstable strips, CS hat, CU hat. Hat stands for the strips being inside of the nice domain, and C prime, S and U. Now, what one can prove that they are either disjoint or nested. So the picture is that you have a rectangle, you have a nice, you have a hyperbolic branch. And then the new branch, the second one will be, and you have a point X. So it must be, if both of them contain some point X, say there is a point X in this one and in the stable one, then they must be nested. So one of them will be a subset in another one. Or otherwise they are completely disjoint, in there are no point in the stable which will belong to the stable of another branch. So that means that you can choose a subcollection I prime. So you can order all the branches by this nested property. It's a partial order because not every two branches are nested, which means that you have partial order in the set of indices IA, which we can denote the set I prime A, which consists of those, is a maximal set with respect to this partial order. So you get this, those sets. So in other words, once you have a point X, you choose the maximal branch, the branch which for which the stable strip is the biggest possible one. And if you do that, they will be disjoint, and that gives you the S sets which partition the base of the tower. So now you have all elements of the Young Tower. You have a base which has direct product structure. You have S sets and respectively U sets, which U sets that you obtain by taking images of S sets under the corresponding time, because they form a hyperbolic branch. And all you need to do is to verify Markov property and verify bounded distortion and verify integrability. So that's the three property you need to do to verify. Well, the Markov property is immediately followed from hyperbolic branch property. That's almost immediate. The verification of the bounded distortion required some estimates, and it follows from the fact that within the hyperbolic branch property, when you consider the map Fi that moves CS into CU, this map is uniformly hyperbolic. And that is the reason why we can prove the bounded distortion property when you go from, when you start from this S sets and go back to the base of the tower. The property that needs to be, the third property is the integrability of the induced time. And that's where we use the fact that we have Lebesgue strong recurrence. And that's the only place where Lebesgue strong recurrence is used. So I told you where the niceness is used, here where the Lebesgue strong recurrence is used. The basic idea of how to prove it was actually it goes back to a result by Pinheiro. He actually introduced us to this idea. That's why we are very simple to him. The idea is that you take the induced time, you take a point x and you look at the induced time at x. You have a function, measurable function on your base. And you apply and consider Birgoff averages of this function. The Birgoff averages of, you want to show that Birgoff averages converge to something finite, because since the system is, the map is ergodic, that it will converge to the integral of the induced function. So you use just Birgoff ergodic theorem to conclude the integral is finite. The idea is that you can tie the Birgoff average of the induced time, time function to Lebesgue strong recurrence in a way that Lebesgue strong recurrence gives you a positive frequency of return. And you can connect the Birgoff ergodic, which average to the positivity, to the frequency of return to the tower. And Lebesgue strong recurrent property gives you positivity of the return, which means that the Birgoff averages are finite. So the connection is that the Birgoff averages, the limit of Birgoff averages is equal to the inverse of the frequency of return. So if the frequency of return is zero, then the Birgoff average converges to infinity. If the frequency of return is positive, the Birgoff averages converge to a finite number. So that's basically the relation between integrability of the return of the induced function and Lebesgue strong recurrence. So that completes the proof of the theory, because the final result of existence of SRB measures immediately follow from the famous result of Leiss and Young, which says that if you have a Young tower, then you have an SRB measure. And that's the end of my talk. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Yasha. So let us all thank Yasha.
Thank you, Yasha.
Do we have questions or comments for Yasha? Pablo Carrasco raised his hand, his virtual hand. So please, Pablo. We can't hear you.
What about now?
Good.
Yeah.
All right. Hi. Hi. I have two questions, which are essentially the same. Probably the first is easier. Have you guys thought if this type of technology of hyperbolic bands or hyperbolic these slices will work with for local and local diffeomorphisms or surfaces?
It very well may be. I mean, the matter is that what I described to you is a kind of a very, very overview of the proof. There are a lot of technical details behind the scene. And if you go to local diffeomorphism, then there may be some things. I mean, on the first glance, I would say yes, it may work. But one has to check all the technical details. There's too many of them to tell to allow me to say definite yes.
Okay, I'm thinking that's a
very interesting question, Pablo. Actually, I think that's a very interesting question. Yeah,
it is.
I at least have not thought about it.
Yeah, nice.
Please go ahead. Yeah. I'm thinking,
because if you have a local endomorphism, if you lift to the inverse limit, you are going to have a two-dimensional lift.
Pablo, we can't hear you well.
Ah, sorry, my system. I'm thinking because if you have a local endomorphism, you can lift to the inverse limit, and it's going to look locally foliated by two-dimensional leaves, and you're going to have the separating properties. So you can define two-dimensional rectangles, those kind of things. So maybe I don't know if anything is known for SRBs for endomorphisms, for example. I think that not much is known.
Sorry, Pablo, are you talking about endomorphisms which are non-uniformly?
Yes, in the tutorials.
Non-uniformly expanding or also with contracting
directions? We expanding and contracting. And I know something, if something can be said for this type of math, in particular, existence of XRVs or something like this. But it's just curiosity. What about a partially hyperbolic two-dimensional center? Do you think that you can reduce this technology, say, to prove the existence of SRVs for that type of maps?
I don't know. I mean, this argument is so far two-dimensional, and it's essential. So I don't know if it can be extended to higher dimension, even assuming that the map is partially hyperbolic. That's hard to say.
Okay.
Great. I mean, I don't
thank know. You so.
Sure.
All right. Thank you so much.
Absolutely.
Someone else wants to ask questions or make comments?
Sorry, just a comment. Maybe it's relevant. I think I saw a paper by Pavel Gora and co-authors on endo SRB measures for example of endomorphism, which is essentially what you described. I mean, I think the idea is that, I mean, it's for just the family of examples. It's not the general result, but maybe it's helpful.
Yeah. I'm sorry, I'm not aware of this paper. So if you...
It's called Singular SRB Measures for a non-one-to-one map of a unit square.
Oh, I see. Okay. Thank you. I will have to take a look at it, but I can't comment.
Someone else? I'm asking because I actually have a bunch of questions, so. Okay, so let me ask my questions.
Yes.
One nice thing is that you mentioned these three kind of ingredients that are used in it, which are, as far as I understand, hyperbolicity and some sort of regularity like temperedness and recurrence. And these three things are were mentioned explicitly in the mini course as being main ingredients either to construct Markov partitions or to construct Young towers. And actually your topic is a topic that has been successfully treated in both methods. So you presented the Young towers construction that uses Young towers, and there is also this work of Sneed that you mentioned. And on the direction of Sneed, I remember that he proves that the SRB measure exists under recurrence, and under strong recurrence, then you get finiteness.
Yes.
So my absolutely. Question is, if instead of only asking Lebesgue strong recurrence, you ask for Lebesgue recurrence, can you build a sort of infinite SRB measure?
I believe so. We have not done that. We just didn't think about that. But probably yes. And because, as I said, the strong recurrence property is used only in the very end when you prove that the tower, the induced time of the tower is integrable. And if it's not integrable, then you get an infinite. So it should be true, but as I said,
well, Yasha, to be honest, I would be more affirmative than that. It's definitely true because we have a firstly turn Young tower,
yes.
And so And so there's no problems, you know, it definitely becomes a sigma finite invariant measure in every case. And we only use the strong recurrence for the integrability. So as Yasha said, we didn't think about stating that explicitly, but.
I just didn't want to be absolutely certain without have things written.
Sure.
Yes, I agree.
Sure. Yeah, yeah.
My final question regards lemma 2. I got curious to know how you are able to, instead of having C square, you can still remain with the same C.
Oh yeah, that's a good question, and I mean it's a technical fact, and but the basic idea is that I mean, how would you do it in the uniformly hyperbolic case? You adapt the metric such that C is one. Okay, and then of course one squared is one, and you get what you need. Mm-hmm. Roughly speaking, that's the same idea here, but technically it's more complicated. But that's what okay. That's all I can say at the moment. But yes, the idea is roughly this.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah, sure. Maybe. Yeah, I mean, maybe if I, yeah, if you don't mind, sure. If I just add something, you know, I mean, for people who are a little bit familiar with the Lyapunov charts, then you know that in the Lyapunov metric, you are uniformly hyperbolic. And actually, the constant comes when you transfer from the Lyapunov metric to the regular metric on the manifold, right? So you just avoid doing that, right? So you stay, you don't need to go up and then down each time. You just stay up on the Lyapunov level until you get to where you want to go, basically.
Yeah, yes. Yeah, that's good.
Yeah.
Yes.
Sure. Okay, do we have any other question or comment for Yasha? Okay, so if not, let's thank Yasha again for his wonderful talk.
Thank you, guys.